Welcome to another International Relations capsule for the Shankar IAS Academy. This edition, we would like to continue to discuss the situation in Afghanistan. This is really a second part of what we discussed last week. Soon after the Americans left unexpectedly, the situation has completely deteriorated in Afghanistan. Taliban, without giving any attention to whatever agreements they may have reached with the Ghani government or the United States, are advancing towards the capital. They are doing it in such a way that first they capture the surrounding cities and particularly the border areas, leaving Kabul for the time being. But it's very clear that they are advancing towards Kabul, and their objective is to dislodge Ashraf Ghani's government and take over Afghanistan. There is really no obstacle to this, because there is really nobody fighting against the Taliban except some of the Afghan national forces. So naturally, Taliban's power, Taliban's strength, outweighs the strength of the Ghani government now that the Americans have left. Because the Ghani government was being supported and encouraged and funded and financed and equipped with the American forces and the allies. So the Ghani government is completely weak at this point, and Taliban is advancing in different directions. We ourselves know that they came almost 3 kilometers next to the Kandahar Indian Consulate General, and we have withdrawn all the India-based staff from there. In fact, 3 consulates have been vacated. And then we have the Taliban claiming that they have 85% of the territory is already in their hands. So the style of operation is that they are trying to block the borders, like the Central Asian republics, Tajikistan, for example, because a number of troops are supposed to have gone away to Tajikistan just for safety. And supplies could come from there towards the Kabul government. So to prevent both these, they are operating on the borders. So the border towns have been occupied, and they are not allowing any transfer of goods or people from the Central Asian republics to Afghanistan. And surprisingly, they are also holding the 2 entry points from Pakistan. And there, apparently, the Pakistani groups, some Mujahideen kind of groups, are slowly filtering into Afghanistan. Then there is an opening near China, and that border has also been protected. So it's a kind of chakravyuh movement that they encircle the Kabul government and Mr. Ghani. What else is happening? India has not had a major role in Afghan negotiations. Very late in the day, once we knew that the Americans were definitely withdrawing and the Taliban is likely to come to power, we opened some tentative discussions with Taliban. And also, we hear that we have had some discussions with Pakistan also. But last few days, the peacemaker in the region has become India. Particularly our External Affairs Minister, Mr. Jay Shankar. He has been on a mission, almost a frantic mission, moving around in the region to find out if there is any possibility of establishing peace. And the repeated hope he expresses is that Afghanistan's future should not be its past. So while everybody else thinks that history will repeat itself in Afghanistan, in the sense that like the Soviet Union left, then Taliban came to power, then the United States came and ousted Taliban, and now the United States has left, so Taliban comes to power. That is the presumption everywhere. But is there another alternative is what Mr. Jaishankar is exploring. And that's why I'm calling this episode as one on Indian initiatives. As I said earlier, India was not a direct party in these negotiations, even from the beginning. Even the United States started this discussion on Afghanistan many years ago. Even at that time, India was never invited on the ground that we had no common border with Afghanistan. We had the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir has, but at the moment, de facto, there is no border. And Pakistan insisted that, therefore, India should not be a direct party in the negotiations. But we were very much part of the building of the Afghan government. So with the American support militarily, India did not intervene militarily, but we did get ourselves involved in humanitarian activities. We had a lot of sympathy for what India was doing. We lost a diplomat, we lost some soldiers. But in spite of all that, we persisted. Because Americans did not appreciate it very much, because President Trump once said, oh, what are Indians doing in Afghanistan? Simply building some libraries or something. And he wanted India to be involved militarily in Afghanistan, which of course we are not willing to do. We have refrained from doing so under different circumstances. The Americans would have welcomed us. The Soviets would have welcomed us, but we refrained from doing so. We kept saying that what we need is an Afghanistan free of foreign forces and a government in Kabul, which is independent, which is inclusive, which is Afghan-owned and Afghan-oriented government. So in this situation now, what are the possibilities? Mr. Jaishankar went first to Iran, where he mentioned that the consensus that existed between Iran and India and partly Soviet Union in the 90s is still valid. But this did not create any response. How is that valid today? It was Soviet Union occupying, and we were trying to help out a process of reconciliation in Afghanistan. And that is not the situation now. Soviet Union had not left. They stayed on and installed another government, and we were working together to strengthen it. But now the situation is the United States has left without leaving any support or supplies to this government to survive. Many in the United States feel that they owed it to Mr. Ghani to support him for some time. But as far as we know, there is no indication that the United States is going to continue to support Mr. Ghani's existence, either militarily or financially. Even if they have done that, they have not announced it. But Mr. Ghani is very confident. He says we will continue the discussions in Doha. There have been some understandings on this withdrawal, like the Taliban will not engage all the militants and Al-Qaeda and others and join together against the government. And they will probably respect the authority of the central government for some time at least, etc. This is the kind of understanding we hear that being made in Afghanistan. But nobody is talking about that. So Mr. Ghani is saying that we are going to talk in Doha, continue to talk with Taliban and find a solution. And meanwhile, he expects the United States to support him. But the United States has not given any such indication. The envoy, the special envoy, Khalisan, of the American special envoy in Afghanistan, has only made one promise. He said that unless the new government is a popular government, popularly supported by government, government of all people. We will not recognize it. Well, that is not much of a threat, because the Taliban government has existed for many years in the past without the support of the recognition of the United States. There are only one or two countries who had recognized Taliban government in Afghanistan. So that is not a big threat. Russia, where of course Mr. Jaishankar went, made some noises about the need for avoidance of terrorism and also need for peace. But they are not willing even to criticize Pakistan for what it is doing. The only person who is criticizing Pakistan is Mr. Ghani himself, who says that Pakistan has been allowing Mujahideen forces to enter into Afghanistan in the recent period. So he does not expect his government to fall, and he believes that some other process could be set in. Russia has condemned the United States for withdrawing. Exactly what they did. They condemned withdrawal and saying that it was a mission failed. And the only offer that the United States is making is that if the new government is not fully representational, there will be no recognition. The situation has inevitably created some instability in Central Asian republics. Those countries are very concerned. But as it happened, Mr. Jaishankar attended two conferences, not specifically addressing Afghanistan, but generally in the context of what is happening in Afghanistan is extremely significant. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization had held a meeting of its grouping. It has very interesting composition: Russia, China, India, Pakistan, and four Central Asian countries. And the fact that a meeting was held, not specifically for Afghanistan, but still they came out with a declaration or a statement which emphasized the need to avoid terrorism, avoid conflict, and peaceful solution. Again, there is no action. Nothing addressed to Pakistan to do something about it. Nothing addressed to United States to do something about it. And therefore, this is kind of a pious declaration. It has the support of our government, and Mr. Jaishankar made the right statements there, explaining the situation very well. Then there was in Tashkent another meeting with more or less the same people. Pakistan was there, India was there. This was all about connectivity in Central Asia. Again, another theme, but there can be no connectivity in Central Asia if Taliban is going to take over Kabul. So they urge that Taliban should hold peace talks. Taliban should not support terrorist organizations. And Central Asia, there should be peace. And talking about connectivity itself, Mr. Jaishankar spoke about the economic viability being very important for connectivity, and also financial responsibility. So, side by side with all this, you have the Ghani government doing something, you have the SCO doing something, you have the connectivity conference doing something. But these are all in the expectation that there will be some kind of a normalcy in Afghanistan. But all military observers say with the same kind of conviction that all this is not going to work. So what is India trying to do? India is trying to show to the world that that peace in this region is very important. And we should not allow the past of Afghanistan to prevail. In the sense that it should not be Taliban government all over again, with all the implications. In fact, President Bush Jr., who started the war in 2001, criticized President Biden, for withdrawing from Afghanistan. And he said, "You are doing a great injustice to the people of Afghanistan, because the Taliban government, which will come to power, will be definitely anti-people, people of Afghanistan themselves." And he even said that it will be the women in Afghanistan who are going to suffer. There will be no gender equality, there will be persecution of women, etc. In the middle of all this, there has been a negative development, which must have surprised Mr. Jaishankar in India, is that a new Quad has been announced. You know about the Quad, US, India, Australia, and Japan. But out of the blue has come a new Quad. It is a Quad only in the sense it has four countries, and these are US, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Uzbekistan. So what is the logic of this? Which Pakistan, which Afghanistan, which kind of Quad is it? What is its purpose? If China is accusing India, Australia, Japan, and United States for creating a NATO in Asia, what is the meaning of this new Quad? Who is it against? Who is it for? The Americans have not explained it fully, but they are talking about a kind of economic grouping which can take care of the situation in Afghanistan and the Central Asian republics. So to which nobody can object, and there it goes. So these are the different strands we find at the moment. And nobody knows how long this will go on. But the most significant thing, as far as I can say, is the softness that Taliban is showing towards the Chinese. This is new because in the last occasion, the Chinese were not involved. But this time, the Chinese are much more aggressive, and they have this Belt and Road Initiative, which would very much fit in with the situation which is developing, so that Beijing, through the other countries, through Pakistan, through Afghanistan, to Tajikistan, and then create a kind of sphere of influence for China. There are two theories. One is China will just take over, as it were, through Pakistan. Because China will not directly take over the country, but using Pakistan, dominate the situation. And the Taliban will run the government, and they will be able to influence the entire region. And this is a new danger, because Pakistan and Taliban together itself is very anti-Indian. We have known that. Even this time, they have said that they will set fire to all the facilities that India had built for Afghanistan. At the same time, they have told the Chinese that the Chinese will be free to come and help us in whatever way they want, and we will reassure your security. So China, Taliban, Afghanistan, Taliban, Pakistan is likely to be the eventual situation in that part. So China is just waiting in the wings, and they are interacting with various countries, but China has no interest, as they say, to put the boot on the ground. That they will not do. Will China be the next empire to fail in Afghanistan? That is a truism, that Afghanistan is the grave of many empires. So we had the Soviet Union. The pattern was very clear. Soviet Union entered Afghanistan at a time when the internal situation was quite bad. And as a neighboring country, they felt responsible to take charge. And so they went in and occupied. And at that time, one of the very few countries, maybe the only country outside the Soviet Empire and Soviet alliance, India was the only country which supported the Soviet Union. Because Mrs. Gandhi had the vision to know that if Afghanistan is left alone without a solid support from some country, some neighboring country, it will certainly go to the dogs. And therefore, we decided to support the Soviet Union, and we, our relations with the United States deteriorated very much. We had very serious bilateral problems with them. And they kept asking us, why are you not asking Soviet Union to withdraw from Afghanistan? We kept on saying foreign countries should not occupy other countries, etc., etc., in pretty simple terms. But we never opposed the Soviet action. And even when the Soviets started withdrawing and when they installed the Najibullah government, we supported them in whatever way we can. The United Nations was involved. The United Nations envoy was playing a role in making sure that Najibullah is not overthrown or killed, but it happened. And even the UN troops were in the danger of being attacked by the Taliban. India was willing to take on Najibullah as a refugee in India, but even that was considered inappropriate. And Mr. Narasimha Rao decided that we would not, his family was already here, but he would not be allowed to come in. And Najibullah, of course, was killed in this bargain. And of course, the Soviet Union completely left. And then Taliban came in full force. And then we know the story of how terrorism developed, terrorism direct against the United States, Osama bin Laden, the bombing of 9/11, etc. Till then, that what happened was that the United States never felt that the terrorism threatening the world would come from Afghanistan-Pakistan region. They kept saying that this India is saying this simply to blame Pakistan for what is happening. So they thought that terrorism was on the other side, in the Middle East. The Palestinians were the terrorists. But the 9/11 proved that it was the terrorism that affected the United States came from this area. And President Bush started off his war on terrorism. And he overthrew the Taliban very fast. But it cannot really control the whole region. And a point came when President Obama himself, and after that President Trump and President Biden, felt that they should withdraw. And they withdrew rather dishonorably. Even before the date of the announcement came, they withdrew. And like the Soviets, the Americans also became a disaster as far as Afghanistan is concerned. So the situation is grave, and India's efforts to see that there is a stable government in Afghanistan does not have many papers. We do not know what each one wants to do, but clearly there is no action plan. Even after Mr. Jaishankar's meeting with all possible people involved, we probably are talking to Pakistan also. So the situation is totally uncertain. But we must take credit that India has made an effort. But whether we should have made an effort earlier, whether our taking this effort at this time will help us, all these we do not know. If the anti-Indian feeling among the Taliban is still very strong, as it appears to be, a dam was bombed, dam which built by India, And they're talking about destroying all the Indian institutions. So, but what Mr. Jaishankar is saying is a lot of sense. That today's Afghanistan is not the Afghanistan of 1996. It should be given, we should be fair to the future generations of Afghanistan. But when we say all this, the whole world knows what we want. We do not want a Taliban-dominated government, further dominated by the Pakistanis and then by the Chinese. So that would be disaster number one. And this is something which is known to the world, so they are polite to us. They recognize what we are saying is right. And it is all very appropriate words that the minister has used. No aggressive statements, but simply saying that we need cooperation in this area, and particularly in this context of the COVID-19, as well as Chinese aggression in Ladakh. All these are complicated matters, and therefore we need peace, and so we are willing to work with, whether it is Iran. Iran has now good relations with China. Russia is also more inclined towards China. So Russia is a candidate for supporting us, or supporting peace. Iran is one of them. And the United States, of course, does not want to get involved, but might play a helpful role by not recognizing a Taliban government. So whether Mr. Jaishankar's initiatives or India's initiative in this regard will be a success or not is an open question. But most people believe that this won't have much of an impact because the lines are already drawn, and it may be difficult to make any country intervene in a particular way. But the option of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, conference in Tashkent on connectivity, these are all things which show the imperative need for peace. But unfortunately, the people of Afghanistan, who are divided into tribes in any case, seem to have supported the Taliban. And even if the Taliban goes slow, eventually they will take the Kabul government. So Indian initiatives certainly will be welcomed by the world, but will indeed be a success or not, we do not know. The possibility is that we may have to deal with Taliban, we'll have to deal with Pakistan, and deal with China also. And that's a huge responsibility that India has. But India cannot behave any differently. And we'll always be pleading and arguing for peace, arguing for development, arguing for economic cooperation. So we have considerable influence in the Central Asian region, Central Asian countries, and we can probably get some help from them. But otherwise, we need to see how the situation develops. So that's what I wanted to say about the Indian initiatives. These are significant. This may have an impact, but not to the extent and not as fast as we would expect. So at least we will the credit for trying something which is in the interest of everyone. Thank you very much. Yes, Pakistan is included in the Quad. It's very surprising. Americans agreeing to a Quad with Pakistan in it and Afghanistan in it. So this has surprised everybody. But Pakistan has been included. Well, first of all, they could have remained without withdrawing, without a proper agreement. The Doha agreement should have been properly negotiated. So United States could have waited. That is one option. Second option, if they wanted to leave, they could have establish some system, like the Soviets did in the case of Najibullah, have some kind of arrangement for the Kabul government to continue with financial and some military support. So that also they could have done. They have done none of those. And they are simply offering that they will not recognize the Taliban government unless it is lawfully established. Well, who is betraying whom? They are not betraying Afghanistan. They are trying to take over Afghanistan and run it the way they want it. So, and there is considerable support for Pakistan. Many people don't think that even the Durand line is a border. Some people think that these are tribal areas, people go in and go out, and therefore it is not such a respected international border. Such a question has also been raised. Yeah, but the principle of non-alignment is not pulling us back from any of these arrangements necessary. As long as we are doing it under our own wisdom, non-alignment is not violated in any way, like we aligned ourselves with the Soviet Union at one point. So if we work with the United States in this particular context, nobody will accuse you of giving up non-alignment. But the important thing is, in this changing environment, whether it will be wise for us to completely identify ourselves with the United States. In fact, it has already happened. Now the Quad has happened and it is a reality. And everybody knows that India is on the side of the United States. There's no question about that. But what we are trying to do is to not provoke a confrontation with China. Because we are the only country with a long border, land border with China and all these countries. So on that, we are being very careful. In fact, you suggested that we could go with the United States. There are some people who are suggesting, why not go with China? Yes, go and make friends with China and work out an arrangement. There we know the Chinese will accept you, provided you are willing to accept a secondary position in Asia, which I don't think India is willing to do. That is really the question. There is no equal relationship as far as China is concerned with India. They think that they have defeated India and India must accept that position and become some kind of a supplicant to China. And that is all that they will accept. But they will not accept a situation where the two countries are equal. But in any case, we are not equal. China is 5 times bigger than India in terms of economic strength, technology, finance, everything.
Yeah.
They are much ahead of us. So what we have is only the two cultural giants of Asia, and we are equal. And that was true in 1962. They were not very superior to us, but they still defeated us. So there is some inevitability of adversarial relationship with China, which is difficult to demolish, in my view. So we will have to be non-aligned between US and China. And maybe non-aligned between US, China, and Russia. All these are options are there where we retain our identity and retain our sovereign power, but may not be able to influence events entirely in our direction. And that's what diplomacy is all about. You could just go and join somebody and fight and win and come back and join somebody. But that is not diplomacy. So here there's a situation which we have to use according to our best lights. And that's what we are doing now. If we fail, then we have other options. So all these options are open, and all these options were open for the last 70 years. And so we have not given up the Dalai Lama, definitely not. Okay. And we have repeatedly said that the Dalai Lama will have to find his own successor. It should be a Tibetan leader. And the Chinese must keep off, and all those things we have already said. But at the same time, we don't want to play the China card, as we are often told to do, because that will be a point of no return. Even the Dalai Lama himself did not want India to have a confrontation with China. He was willing to talk to the Chinese, but he did not insist that India should talk to the Chinese. Taiwan is an option, Hong Kong is an option, but all these are games in which we are not normally involved because we have not been an expansionist power. And we deal with our neighbors with respect and then, of course, with strength if it is required to be. But we are not a superpower which goes about fixing Taiwan or fixing Hong Kong or anything like that. That kind of ambition we don't have. As long as they leave us to have an independent and peaceful life, India will be quite happy. And whatever we will do, otherwise, would be only for our own sake of our own peace and development. These options are there, but whether we'll exercise in one way or the other, we don't know. But if you are looking at India's history, you will find that we will not do anything such drastic things. We will abide by the international law, abide by the claims, et cetera, et cetera. So we don't unnecessarily interfere in these matters. And that is because of our own interest in remaining independent. So we are in troubled waters, but I wrote somewhere that Afghanistan is the last flank of, like Abhimanyu's Padma Vyuha. Okay. So that's also close. Now what do we do? So which means we may have to think of, so when Mr. Jaishankar, I know he has come back, when he comes back, I'm sure he'll sit down with the Prime Minister and see what our options are. You know, the SEO, now that the Chinese have taken it over, has assumed some importance. But this was a group of former Soviet socialist republics. That is how the SEO originally was formed. But now India is there, Pakistan is there, and all that, and it has become a mix of many things. But the Chinese have completely taken charge of it. Whatever SEO does will be done on the basis of the Chinese. So the republics or these countries, circulation countries, have their own agenda, their own relationship with each other. So that you know, our foreign minister went to Georgia. People raised questions as to why Georgia now? Because Georgia is wanting to join the European Union. So we are giving a signal to Russia that, we can also support Georgia to go to the European Union. So such options we sometimes exercise, but certainly not in any manner which would affect their sovereignty. So they may have their own politics, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, etc. And they may be playing in different forms, which we do not know. At least I do not know where exactly the lines are drawn among them. Apart from peace talks, what India can do? Well, that's what I was discussing. Not many things we can do. So we are trying to do our best to save the situation in the interest of not only of India, but also of the region. There's nothing else we can do. We cannot go and fight in Afghanistan. That's out of the question. Then what more can we do except to push these countries forward and get them to act in a rational manner, Pakistan and China and Taliban itself. But they are now in a winning mood, and therefore they are likely to not listen to such advice. So only if they lose for some reason, then they might look around for support. But at the moment, Pakistan has no reason to hold their horses and try and see something can be done for India, their Pakistan relations. But their objective is completely Jammu and Kashmir. And this will be a godsend opportunity for them to direct the Taliban into Jammu and Kashmir. So that is their prime, what they call the core issue. And if they can get some satisfaction on the core issue, and then that will be a matter of India's territorial integrity and sovereignty. So thank you very much, everyone. We'll meet again next week. Thank you.